The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
This is the day that the Lord has made. I'd like to welcome you all this morning. It's great to see your smiling faces, and also welcome those who are watching our service online. I would like to draw your attention to the announcements in the back of your bulletin. I'll highlight a few. Please sign the little tablet called the Who's Who in the Pew and put the sheet in the offering plate when it comes to you. Dedication Sunday is November 19th. If you can't be here that day, you can mail or bring your pledge cards to the office. It's still time to sing in the Christmas cantata. If you're interested, please seek him or any choir member. We invite you to share your voices. And I have something else to invite you to. There is yet another opportunity that this wonderful church presents that can benefit everybody, and it's free. It's called the library. We have a library right in down the hall. There are 200 or 300 books in the library. There are nonfiction, fiction, large print, and children's books. And anybody can check them out. There's no due date and there's no fines, although we do ask you to return them eventually. We would be happy for you to come and peruse the books and help yourselves. And also, it just so happens that we have a book club that meets once a month, the second Wednesday of the month at 1:30. This next Wednesday is book club, and we are discussing a book called A Man Called Ova. You might have seen the movie A Man Called Otto with Tom Hanks, but the movie was made about this book, A Man Called Ova, written by Frederick Bachman. It's a wonderful book full of philosophy about life, and it's going to be a good one to discuss. So we invite anybody who wants to come, 1:30 on Wednesday. And even if you haven't gotten hold of the book, we'd welcome discussion. So please feel free. Now, will you please stand in body or in spirit for the call to worship? Come, all who are weary from the past week. We come seeking rest. We come seeking comfort. Come, all who are in need of inspiration for the week ahead. We come seeking God's truth, word, and worship that will set us on the faithful path. Come, all who are humble, open, and ready to learn. We come as God's students, ready to listen and learn. Let us pray. Most astounding God, you lead us through deserts and grant us safe crossings. You save us from trouble and deliver us from distress. You satisfy our hunger and quench our thirst with righteousness and mercy. When we lose our way, you pull us back to you and overwhelm us with love. All honor and glory are yours, our Master, our Teacher, our Friend. Amen. Now for the hymn, Praise Ye the Lord Almighty, number 35. be seated. Confession requires a humble heart. Let us bow before our God to honestly confess our sins, praying together the prayer of confession found in your bulletin. God, our teacher, we often exalt ourselves while evaluating and judging others. We assume too much and don't invest enough in listening, learning, and seeking to understand. You call us to humility, yet we resist, puffing ourselves up with prideful arrogance and rigid certainty. Forgive us, soften our hearts, and open our minds to all we have yet to learn. Amen. Your guilt has departed, and your sin is blotted out. Know that you are forgiven, and be at peace. Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Now you may stand if you feel comfortable and exchange signs of peace or shake hands.
Thank you.
so good to see you this morning. Come on, have a seat. I got something to show you. How are you doing today? You look beautiful. Hi, how you doing? Do you know what this box is? This is called a gift box for a boy or a girl. And it's from a program called Samaritan's Purse. And it's, some people call it a shoebox project. There may be things like this going on at your schools. But it is about helping children in need around the world, receiving Christmas presents that are in these boxes that they may not otherwise get to receive. We're so lucky, aren't we? We have pretty much whatever we want, but some kids don't. So this is why we fill the boxes. Many of the children live in remote areas of the world, maybe islands or small villages in the mountain, but they will always be children in need. Operation Christmas Child is part of Samaritan's Purse, the international relief organization that assists after natural disasters, and there are always those. So this box, you can decide if you want to fill it with presents for a boy or a girl. You can decide how old they are. And sometimes I find that it helps if you pick out things you would like to fill the box with, because that way you're pretty sure they would like them, right? So if you see this at school or at church, ask your mom and dad if you can have a box to fill, and they will help you. You can put in things like, okay, what do you put in here, like liver and onions? No. Things that you would like. So let's see what kind of things could be in here. Oh, you could put in a soccer ball with a pump, or a doll, or a stuffed animal, or flip-flops. You could put in toy cars, jump ropes, yo-yos, toys that light up and make pretty noises. You could put in toothbrushes, washcloths, combs, hairbrushes. Sometimes when we're, you know, mom says brush your teeth, brush your hair, it's kind of a pain. But think about if you never had a toothbrush of your own, or a comb, or a brush to make you feel better. This is how we help. You could put in school supplies like pens or pencils, sharpeners, crayons, markers. Everybody loves those. Coloring books, picture books, socks, sunglasses, jewelry and watches, and flashlights with batteries. So these are just some of the things you could put in. And if you want to ask mom and dad how to go about it, we have a collection of boxes going out that will be mailed to a company that delivers the boxes to the people who need them. It's another way of saying Merry Christmas. Will you say a prayer with me? Dear God, thank you that we are so lucky to be able to share our gifts with people who are having trouble. Help us to send a silent prayer and a loving wish with each box. Thank you, Lord, for our blessings. Amen. Thanks for coming. We'll see you next time. Now, we're going to do the prayer for illumination. You call us through your word, read and proclaimed, Holy God. May our eyes be open and our hearts willing to follow wherever your spirit leads. Amen. Today's first lesson is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 9 to 13. It's encouragement from Paul, who like to write letters to remind people what was expected of them. So he says, "You remember our labor and toil, brothers and sisters. We worked night and day that we might not burden any of you while we proclaimed the gospel of God. You are witnesses, and God also, how pure, upright, and blameless our conduct was toward you believers. As you know, we dealt with each one of you like a father with his children, urging and encouraging you and pleading that you lead a life worthy of God, who calls you into his own kingdom and glory. We also constantly give thanks to God for this, that when you received the word of God that you heard from us, you accepted it, not as a human word, but as what it really is, God's word, which is also at work in you believers."
Good morning. Our gospel lesson is found in Matthew 23, verses 1 through 12. Through these words, may we hear the word of the Lord to and for us. Then Jesus said to the crowds and to his disciples, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit on Moses' seat. Therefore, do whatever they teach you and follow it. But do not do as they do, for they do not practice what they teach. They tie up heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on shoulders of others, but they themselves are unwilling to lift a finger to move them. They do all their deeds to be seen by others, for they make their phylacteries broad and their fringes long. They love to have the place of honor at banquets and the best seats in the synagogues, and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and have people call them rabbi. But you're not to be called rabbi, for you have one teacher, and you're all brothers and sisters. And call no one your father on earth, for you have one father, the one in heaven. Nor are you to be called instructors, for you have one instructor, the Messiah. The greatest among you will be your servant. All who exalt themselves will be humbled, and all who humble themselves will be exalted." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Do as I say, not as I do. Have you ever heard that? Spoken it yourself? Most parents have, at one time or another, jokingly, if not seriously, said, "Do as I say, not as I do." But somehow, children never seem to listen. Why? Because apparently, actions speak louder than words. Actions speak louder than words. You have to walk the talk. Do what you say or you lose all credibility. If your boss says everyone needs to give 110% and be a team player, then goes home early, takes long lunches, and throws you under the bus every time something goes wrong, you don't believe them. You're going to give about 50 to 60% effort. The best leaders lead by example. This is true for parents, politicians, preachers, and teachers. You have to walk the talk. Actions speak louder than words. This is a great theme in ancient wisdom literature. Aristotle said that if you want to speak persuasively, character is the first prerequisite. If you have competence, good intent, and empathy for your audience, that is more persuasive than good arguments or a nice turn of phrase. The Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians verse 1, 13, verse 1, "If I speak with the tongues of angels and have not love, I am but a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal." Jesus gets right to it. Walk the talk. If this were easy, there would not be so much written about lining up our speech with our character. If this were easy, Congress would not have a 17% approval rating. When I have writer's block with a sermon, it's seldom lack of creativity. It's more a fear that I cannot live up to what I say. What is so hard? Why is it so hard to walk the talk? Personally speaking, I have high hopes and ideals. My imagination outstrips my ability. I can see how I want to be. I can write and speak it clearly. But it's very hard to live up to my ideal in reality. It takes more courage and effort and fortitude than I can sometimes summon. We all fall short of our ideals, and that is so very human. I think Jesus is getting at something deeper here in the text, something that is often more unconscious inside us. In our readings since September in Matthew's gospel, Jesus has been going hard at the Pharisees and other religious leaders. They are like the complaining laborers who don't like others getting paid the minimum wage. They are the wicked servants in the vineyard who take what is not theirs. They don't show up to the great royal wedding banquet. They challenge Jesus on taxes and carry around Caesar's coin. Today's text is Jesus' parting shot at the Jerusalem leadership. These guys are so bad that by Matthew 23, we're all behind Jesus thinking, "You give it to them, Jesus. Unmask those hypocrites." We like that kind of thing. It's why I have watched the likes of Trevor Noah and Stephen Colbert. Both are great at lampooning anyone who is a hypocrite. If anyone walked the talk, they would be out of a job. Isn't it interesting that one of our major sources of entertainment is watching people get taken down a notch? The positive reason is we need humor as a release, or it would just make us too angry. I know I cannot watch the news without a safety valve of humor. In modern terms, Jesus says to his opponents, "You like having that Harvard sticker on the back window of your car. You want everyone to call you Reverend or Doctor. You name drop so easily when you pray at the mayor's inauguration. In brief, you're all about you. You are a bunch of egomaniacs," to use Freud's language, egotistical. And here's the problem with being ego-focused. Most of us are not very good at estimating ourselves. People of status consistently overestimate their own abilities and underestimate the abilities of others. The point is, human beings are terrible at estimating their own abilities. We over or underestimate ourselves and seldom have a spot-on view of who we are. Know thyself is great advice, but hard to do. Why is that? It's what I think, that true self-knowledge forces us to change. If we think too highly of ourselves, negative feedback not only hurts, but it means we need to change some things, admit when we're wrong, ask advice, be more of a team player, work on our weakness. Honesty brings change, and change doesn't come easy. It's true, if we underestimate ourselves, we can be scared to find out we have more potential than we thought. Others may ask things of us. We might have to risk failure to be true to ourselves. And it's easier to think less of ourselves and sit on the sidelines. To know thyself means we would continually be challenged. It sounds like hard work, but it's not as hard as holding up a false ego. We're done hearing Jesus skewer the self-righteous with his clever parables. But now he turns to his audience and says, "Do whatever the scribes and the Pharisees teach you and follow it, but do not do as they do. For they do not practice what they teach. Don't you be like that. Walk the talk." And that makes me want to say, "Easy there, Jesus. I didn't expect this to get personal about me." But Jesus challenges us to be humble. Too often people think that means being down on yourself. But there's nothing inconsistent with valuing your best abilities and being humble. If you're good, you're good. But get some feedback. Everyone needs at least one honest friend. They can be a pain, but find people who will tell you, "Well done," when you get it right, and give you that look when you don't. Humility is the fruit of listening. Asking questions such as, "What do you think? What would you do?" If you're still questioning yourself, the rightness of your actions, struggling with your ego, Jesus says this: "Be a servant. Be of service to others." If you truly want to be free of the burdens of ego, help someone else, and you might forget all about yourself. And then you are free indeed. This is what saints do. They find freedom and fulfillment in service to others. They walk the talk. As St. Francis of Assisi said, "Preach the gospel always. And if you have to, use words." So I began this reflection with the time-worn, cynical parental statement, "Do as I say and not as I do." I'll end it with another time-worn statement that can be taken positively or negatively. It's not where you start out, but where you end up. Matthew lifts up the Pharisees as a cautionary tale. They started out with good intentions, but some ended by seeking to be great, by seeking to be exalted. They started out concerned for holiness, but some ended in exclusion. They started out seeking to recognize God in all things, but some ended by seeking recognition at banquets and in the synagogue. Matthew wants disciples of Jesus to both start out and end up at a radically different place. He wants his church to honor the heart of the law of love of God and neighbor, and serve both with purity of heart and intention. Matthew calls the church of his day to be both faithful to its Jewish roots and responsive to the new vision proclaimed by Jesus, to be like the wise scribe portrayed by Jesus, trained for the kingdom of heaven, who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. Jesus calls the church in Matthew to live in such a way that they can say to the world, do as we say and do as we do. How to accomplish this? By remembering that in their community, as in this community, the greatest among them must be their servants. And all who exalt themselves would be humbled, and all who humble themselves will be exalted. Join with me in prayer. Merciful and faithful God, let your word be at work within us today that we may be faithful to you, and every breath be a prayer of gratitude. You sent to us the true Messiah who teaches us the ways of the righteous and brings us into your presence, forgiven and restored. Open our hearts, our ears, our minds to your nourishment by word and sacrament, that we might willingly obey and believe through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Our affirmation of faith this morning is the Apostles' Creed. I invite all in body or in spirit to stand that we may recite the historic confession of the Christian Church. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We're gathered here to remember. We remember how Jesus took bread on the night of his betrayal, lifting it up with thanksgiving, saying, "This is my body given for you." We remember how Jesus lifted the cup, saying, "This is the new covenant sealed in my blood." When we share this meal, we remember. Jesus shared many meals with his followers, feeding hungry crowds with a little bread and fish, gathering with his disciples to remember how God saved the people, much as we're doing right here, and breaking bread with them after he rose from the dead. May his memory be a blessing. Join with me in the great prayer of thanksgiving. May the God of the table be with you. Let us offer our hearts to God. Lift up your voices in song to the one who serves us. So let us pray. Standing at the edge of chaos, you cried out, exalted love. And all creation sprang forth from the goodness of your word. Grace overflowed from your heart, racing through the deep valleys of hope, creating us in your image, breathing life and joy into us. You drew us near to you so we could live in joy with you. But we chose to wander through the deserts of death, paving over Eden's promise with our sins. Like a parent with her children, you encouraged us to listen, sending the prophets to bring us back. But we would not listen, tying up the burdens of our lives and putting them on their backs. Then you chose to send Jesus to be the witness to your never-ending love for us. So with wanderers and witnesses, with those who cried out to you and those who followed your promises, we lift our songs with our sisters and brothers. You are blessed. You are holy. Jesus Christ, your Son, our teacher, is the one who comes to redeem us. Seeing the barren lives we lead, he came to till the rich soil of your hopes and dreams, that it may bear life in us. Watching us stumble along sin's side streets, he takes us by the hand to lead us to your feast. When we would allow our pride to become entangled with death, he gently takes this burden from off our shoulders, carrying it to the cross and leaving it behind in the tomb as he strides forth into the promised land of resurrection. As we remember his words and witness, as we would let his teachings shape our lives, we speak of what we believe. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ was sent to be God's witness. Christ is our teacher of the way. Christ will come to welcome us home. As we gather around this table, pour out your spirit upon us in the gifts of the bread and the cup. As we eat of your brokenness, may we live humbly with others. May we speak with humility to power. As we drink from your grace, may we act humbly in seeking justice. May we serve others with humility and love. And when your light has overcome all shadows, when we're all brought to your table in glory, we will join our sisters and brothers of every time and from every place in praising you forever, Holy One, who did teach us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. The gifts of God for the people of God. I'm going to step to the table. I'm going to be joined by two assisting and serving. You're invited to come front and center, take of the bread, fan out left or right, take the cup. There are trash cans on the sides for the placement of the cups, if you will. If you choose to remain seated but want to take communion, ushers can bring the 2-in-1 wafer juice set to you. So if anybody would like that assistance. You are invited. The bread of heaven. Jesus' body broken for you. Tim, Christ's body broken for you. The bread of heaven. Christ's body broken for you. John, Christ's body broken for you. Mourn the bread of heaven. Pam, Christ's body broken for you. Christ's body. Christ's body broken for you. John, Christ's body broken for you. Broken for you. Bread of heaven. Christ's body. Christ's body broken for you. Chuck, Christ's body broken for you. Christ's body broken for you. Mm-hmm. Bread of heaven. Christ's body broken for you. The bread of heaven. Bob, Christ's body broken for you. Just stay with us. First down. And I'll pick that up again. Let us join together in the prayer after communion. At this table, O God, we are restored, fed, not for our own sakes, but rather to become the hands and feet of Christ for the sake of others. Refreshed and nourished, we're sent forth to love more profoundly and to serve more intensely. Bountiful God, in you there is no scarcity, only abundance. Let each of us manifest the living presence of your grace in every thought, word, and action.
Friends, out of the abundance we have been given, let us humbly present our tithes and offerings to our God. Please join me in the prayer of thanksgiving and dedication. God, you call us to Christ's mission and ministry. Bless these gifts that they might spread the hope of your good news, feed the hungry, shelter the poor, comfort the suffering, and free the captives. Bless us also so that our lives conform to radical love and faithful humility. Amen.
Thank you.
not leave God behind when we leave this sanctuary. God's call to love, to humility, to work and service that benefit all is clear.
Guiding us, inspiring us, enabling us be Christ's body, his hands, his feet, his heart in this God's world. Friends, may the grace, hope, peace, and love of God, our Creator, our Redeemer, our Sustainer, be with us all, now and forever.